Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. We are in the height of application season for PhDs, and I wanted to talk about what to do if you've gotten rejected, reasons you might have gotten rejected, and should you apply to the same lab in the future. These are very kind of complicated questions, and hopefully you don't have to deal with this. Hopefully you'll have smooth sailing, but if you have gotten a rejection, stay tuned to this video for my tips and tricks for getting accepted. Let's jump on in. So first of all, let me be clear, it is okay to be disappointed with rejection. I'm very positive on this channel, but when I get rejections, I feel sad and disappointed and upset. And sometimes I worry that I'm getting rejected rather than my research. So first of all, I just wanna say that it's okay to have negative feelings associated with rejection. We all have them, no matter how positive someone might seem online. They certainly feel negative feelings when they're getting rejected. And there is a lot of rejection in academia. That is honestly kind of the name of the game. I always say, if you're not getting rejections, you're not applying to enough places. So you will get rejected now and also potentially in the future for other things as well. So developing strategies to handle rejection is really, really key. So after you've shaken off some of those negative feelings associated with rejection, how do you move forward? What do you need to think about doing? The first thing to consider are some of the reasons why you actually got rejected. I think that there's three major categories of reasons why PhD students get rejected. So you'll need to determine which category you fall into. The first one is just simply not being as competitive as other applicants. It is a very competitive field out there, especially in 2025, 2026 application cycles. So some of the best people are going to be applying and you just simply might not be as competitive. What does that mean to be less competitive? Well, you might not have publications like they do. You might not have as much time in a lab. You might not have as much knowledge about the topic. You might not have a skill that they're trying to bring in. All of these things are just essentially making your application less strong as other people. So that really has nothing to do with you per se, the bits and pieces of your application material. That's about your preparation. Are you as prepared as other candidates to get into this particular field? So that could be one reason. And the second reason you might have gotten rejected is from a personality misfit. This can be really challenging to determine if you fall into this category because it's really about, did the advisor like you? Did they enjoy talking with you? Did they think that they'd have a fun time working with you? That's really hard to determine. Now, there's certain types of advisors who prioritize personality fit more than other advisors. So you can kind of get a sense if that particular advisor you applied to was really focusing on that. Maybe they're not. So it's really a range, and that is very, very hard to determine. I think within that, maybe something you could identify is if you messed up. So oftentimes when we are interviewing potential PhD students, we're looking for red flags. And this is anything from they're going to be problematic in the lab to they aren't actually committed to the research to they're kind of BSing their way through these skills, that type of thing, right? So it could be that personality misfit was actually really just you stumbling or messing up on something. That's actually really good because then you can, in the future, when you apply, not mess up, do it better, do the application better, and you might have more success. So you'll want to think back at your applications. Did you actually mess up in some way? Was there an awkward situation in some capacity? That might give you a clue, and that's a really easy one to correct moving forward. And the third major category of why you got rejected is potentially that the advisor just didn't have funding. This crazy thing happened last year in 2024 cycle where people thought they'd have money coming in, and with all the funding cuts going on in academia, they didn't end up having the funding that they thought they would. So you might have made all the way to the end of the process and not have gotten an offer simply because there wasn't funding available. That's also a really easy one to figure out because oftentimes they simply tell you, we didn't end up having the funding that we thought we would. But also, this is a really good opportunity to think about sending a follow-up email to advisors that you applied to and got rejected to determine why you were in fact getting rejected. And that brings me to the next section of this, which is how do you move forward from those rejections? The first thing you might consider doing is emailing those advisors and asking if they would give you insights onto why you got rejected or suggestions on how to make your application stronger moving forward. That can be a very mixed bag. It's done in industry all the time, right? So it's very accepted. It is somehow different in academia for whatever reason, in part because it's just uncommon for students to do that. I have had students do that with me, and I was very frank. I explained to them there were some holes in their CV, and over the next year, they should consider filling those holes, and that would make them a stronger applicant if they want to apply to work with me in the future. But not everyone will give you very frank feedback, because in part, it might have been a personality fit, and the advisor might not want to say, I didn't like you, or I didn't enjoy working with you, or I didn't think we'd have a good time together. They're not going to say that. They're going to kind of make some other stuff up. So it is truly a mixed bag sending out those emails asking for feedback as to why you got rejected. It should give you information about if it was a funding issue or if they truly thought your application was promising and they have suggestions on what you should do moving forward to make yourself a stronger applicant. But just be aware that some of the stuff they might say might not be wholly true because it's kind of an uncomfortable situation to be put into trying to give feedback to someone who might find that feedback to be very uncomfortable or it might upset them in some way. So what do you do now? Should you reapply to those same labs? I think you want to do a little bit of information gathering to determine if that makes sense, if it's worth your time or not. In particular, what you'll want to do is take a look at the people who most recently got accepted to that particular lab you're considering reapplying to and look at their CVs. Most PhD students have some type of website or they have information about them online and it often includes their CV. So you can see what their CV looked like going into the program. That's not always the case, but usually you'll be able to find some of this information online. The trick is that you want to compare your CV to theirs and see if there's major gaps. See if they have more publications than you, maybe they've won some awards, maybe they spent a long time doing this research previously. That will give you a clue as to the types of things that your potential advisor really is looking for in a PhD student. Now, ideally what you want to do is then fill in those gaps. So you want to think about, am I the same applicant as I was previously and got rejected? Or have I done something in the last year to fill in those holes in my CV? If you haven't done anything, there's really no need to reapply. I'm gonna be honest with you, unless it was a funding issue. If you're essentially the same applicant, then I don't think you need to waste your time reapplying to that same particular lab. But hopefully you can look and see the gaps in your CV and really supplement some of those things to make sure you're more of a sure thing. Now you're not gonna be able to, you know, do miraculous things, potentially like publish 5 papers before your application, but you can demonstrate that you've identified things that you are deficient in and you're working to supplement some of those additional skills or holes in your CV that you had in the previous application cycle. That actually looks really good when you see students taking initiative when they're applying. Okay, so hopefully you are a better candidate than the previous time that you've applied. The next thing that I recommend you doing is sending an email to that advisor and describing how you have improved your CV. What have you done in the last year that is making you more prepared, more ready, a stronger applicant in the application pool? You can write this email to the advisor saying, you know, I really enjoyed the opportunity to interview with you last year. Since that time, I have done X, Y, and Z. I wanted to know if you think I would be a strong enough candidate to be considered this year. It's very straightforward, simple. You're laying out the things that you did and they will give you a very honest reply, in part because they don't want to filter through more applications than they need to. So if they truly think that you've done things that constitute a reevaluation of your application, they will say so. Now, what you want to be careful of is it's hard because they might say no without saying no. It is very uncomfortable oftentimes for faculty or professors to just say, no, don't apply, okay? So they might kind of beat around the bush. They might say, you know, it looks interesting. You should, you know, consider applying here and other places as well, okay? That is a lackluster response. So if you see any lackluster responses, that's basically a no. They're just too afraid to tell you no outrightly. So if you get a response that it's a resounding yes, definitely reapply, do everything that I've been talking about on this channel to make a really strong application, and hopefully you will get the offer this year. But say you get a lackluster response, what do? Don't apply there. Apply everywhere else, right? There's lots of other places that you could go, and frankly, it just might not be a fit. There might not ever be a situation where you have the perfect CV and et cetera to get into that particular lab. So you need to broaden your horizons. And this is a really kind of unspoken about truth of academia, which is that, you know, we get a lot of rejections and we rarely get our first choice in anything. So most professors didn't necessarily have the university that they're at as their top choice. They probably had several places that they wanted to be, and maybe the one they're at is close to the top choice, but maybe not. Oftentimes we had to move to places that we didn't necessarily want to be. We had to maybe work in a field that was, you know, not exactly the one we wanted to work on. There's lots and lots of compromises, and that might be something you're having to deal with now. So you'll want to broaden your horizon in terms of places that you are willing to apply to have a bigger net and apply to more places. Don't just laser focus on the one or two schools that you want to get into. If they're giving you all these signals of no, you can apply 1,000 times and it's not going to matter. So don't waste your energy. Really try to find a broader range of places that will be acceptable to you. Just make sure and keep an open mind, and you can find a broader ranges of places to apply and hopefully get in this year. I hope you found this helpful. If you thought so, definitely consider hitting the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. Academia can be tough, but you don't have to go through it alone. Keep learning, keep growing, and I'll see you in the next one. Take care.